in Baltimore, Maryland for the 5th annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Last week, Tim Desko scored 5 goals as Syracuse solidified its number one ranking with a win over Virginia. Today, the Orange head south and outdoors to take on shutdown defender Barney Ehrman and number 20 Georgetown. It's the Orange against the Hoyas in game one, next. Welcome to the 5th annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Last year, Syracuse's journey to Baltimore was cut short by Army in the first round. Today, the Orange come to town as the number one team in the country, and they are set to renew their Big East rivalry with Georgetown. Hello and welcome to M&T Bank Stadium. I'm Eamon McEnany, along with the All-American goalie from Johns Hopkins, Quint Kesnick. Paul Carcaterra will join us momentarily from the field. Now, Quint, the season will end in this stadium on Memorial Day. Why does it look like, once again, Syracuse will be a part of championship weekend?
Because they have a super senior class. They've got about 7 guys who are about as focused and galvanized as I've ever seen. They've already won 2 titles, and as a group, they are 48-6 in their career. They're an outstanding group.
The biggest question about Syracuse in the preseason was who will score at the attack. One of the early season answers so far is Tim Desko.
Yeah, the coach's son is off to a great start. He's got 10 goals on 21 shots. He's shooting 50%. He never misses. He was money in the bank against Virginia in the Dome last Friday night. A 5-goal outburst, catching and finishing with finesse and an absolute flair. Look at the behind-the-back shot. Timmy Desko, he's been the main goal scorer from in tight.
Georgetown also likes to play an up-tempo game, and one of the Hoyas' main threats, Zach Angel.
Junior from Southern Maryland can flat-out fly. He is a speed merchant, scoring lately 5 goals in his last 2 games. He can get a step. He's a matchup nightmare on the perimeter. This is a very, very potent Georgetown offense.
And those are impact players brought to you by Warrior.
This game could break the scoreboard here at M&T Bank Stadium. Expect fireworks in a high-scoring game.
For more at the up-and-running game that we are expecting, let's go down to the field and check in with the former Syracuse All-American midfielder, Paul Carcaterra.
Well, dating back to last season, outside of UVA, Georgetown's the only team to put up double digits against Syracuse's defense and first-team All-American goalie John Galloway. The Hoyas love the up-tempo approach to lacrosse. However, it's also been their Achilles heel. They let up an average of 18 goals in their 2 losses this season. It's a concern for Coach Yurick. He knows this unit has to tighten up and get better goaltending play out of goalie Jack Davis to get the W here today.
Jack Davis has been very busy so far this year, facing an average of more than 40 shots a game, 172 in 4 contests to be exact, as the Hoyas have been giving up shots at a rapid pace this year so far.
Coach Yurick told us, you know, we're not going to deviate from what we do, and that is playing up-tempo defense, trying to create transition opportunities. He says, when you play a team like Syracuse, so sometimes that doesn't work out in your favor.
Syracuse in the road orange, Georgetown in the home white, Jeremy Thompson against Brian Tabb. Tabb comes up with it pretty cleanly for the Hoyas, so Georgetown will go to work first in the 5th annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. This is Davey Emola being guarded by McGill.
Early in this game, an emotional challenge for Syracuse. Coming off that emotional win. Everybody patting the Orange on the back this week after taking down Virginia in the Dome. Georgetown loses a midweek game. I sensed a little overconfidence from the Orange yesterday in practice. They are ripe for the taking, especially early in this ballgame.
If you're noticing, the nets are lime green here today. That is a salute to the Headstrong Foundation and its signature color. All the participating schools and coaches welcome the opportunity to call attention to Headstrong and its commitment to finding a cure for all blood cancers. The referees are also wearing lime green jerseys. Nick Colalori, the former Hofstra player who passed away after losing a battle to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and his parents have really become committed to that cause. And there's a goal by Jovan Miller. So Syracuse doesn't waste any time getting on the board. The midfielder out of Syracuse makes it 1-0 Orange.
Starts with a save from Galloway and a gorgeous outlet pass to Joel White. And then Jovan Miller likes his matchup. You see the screen set and he runs parallel to those football hash marks and buries the left-handed bounce shot. Miller does it all. Defense, ground balls. He can score. I have him as a top five midfielder nationally.
The eighth overall pick in the Major League Lacrosse draft by the Rochester Rattlers. Had a chance to talk to their head coach, B.J. O'Hara, this week, and he said his game flat out conducive to Major League Lacrosse in its pace.
And Miller is a worker. Talking to Syracuse's radio analyst, Kyle Federley, he says there's not a day that goes by in the offseason that Jovan Miller doesn't come to that equipment facility and ask for the bag of balls to go out of Manly Fieldhouse and work on his skills. He has really improved from year to year.
How about the story Coach Desco told us when he was a freshman and sophomore and didn't see that much playing time in the games? They would hear about him going to local high schools and working on his skill all by himself on game day. So he certainly has dedicated himself to this sport. So the Orange come up with it again and go to work. 6-on-6.
A couple of Syracuse keys. Talked about avoiding the letdown after the big win. And then handling Georgetown's perimeter pressure. Georgetown will get out on the perimeter, look for turnovers.
There's a big hit by Ehrman as he makes his presence felt right away. The graduate student from here in Baltimore, lower in the boom as Georgetown gets physical.
Barney Ehrman picked up by the Chesapeake Bayhawks in Major League Lacrosse draft after sitting out all of last year with an ankle injury, an athletic specimen.
Spoke to former Maryland head coach Dave Cottle this week, who's now the front office with the Bayhawks as we take a look at that hit. And Quinn, he told me that his years at Maryland, Barney Ehrman was the second most disruptive force they ever played against. The most disruptive, another Georgetown player, Brody Merrill. That's a pretty high compliment.
And Ehrman may be better suited in the pro game to play that long stick midfield position. He's kind of a tweener between being a close defender and a long stick midfielder. But Dave York needs him on the field at all times, and that's why he plays close.
24th overall pick in that draft. Now the Hoyas trying to get on the board. This is Seligman who gives it up to the attack. Emola.
Hoyas keys, they have to clear the ball. Midweek loss to Harvard, they only cleared 10 of 17. And then their interior defense. Their history against Syracuse says that they vacate the crease and allow Stephen Keough to feed on them. He's got 10 goals in three games against Georgetown.
Here is Ricky Mirabito, a Central New York native. Now Dan McKinney, another New Yorker. Miller fell down and in recovery gets the head, but no flag up in the air, so the Hoyas will play on. McKinney draws the pole of Joel White, the All-American. Now Seligman with Amadon. Amadon not necessarily a defensive player.
Oh, he can handle his own. Amadon and Miller give the Syracuse defense a lot of freedom to keep some midfielders on. If they can get the turnover, they look to run.
Morabito turned the corner. Shot got blocked. Now Seligman. Georgetown has to keep it in the box. So we promised you an up-tempo game, and we get a stall warning in the first quarter. Under 11 minutes here to play. Syracuse with the early 1-0 lead. This is Casey, saved by Galloway. Good hit there. So Galloway now has two saves, but Georgetown will hold on to it.
Casey taken down by John Lade after that shot. Weak angle.
Morabito being guarded by Lade. Como can't make the catch on the crease, and McGill comes up with it.
Como was open. He was just handcuffed.
Now Amadon in the middle of the field. Defense to offense for Syracuse. Amadon left open, gets inside, shoots. Save made. And Ehrman wins the race to the end line. Now the referee's going to talk it over.
He kicked the ball out of bounds, so this ball will stay with Syracuse.
So look at Amadon out of Lafayette, New York. Senior. 4 goals last year against the Hoyas. Here's Desco, 8 goals in his last 2 games. Up top to Miller.
Georgetown appears to be in his zone.
Now Marasco.
They've proven that they can't play man-to-man this year so far, and so they throw a zone out, which was effective for Army in the Cadets' loss to Syracuse.
As Paul Carcaterra pointed out in the open, 36 goals allowed in their two losses to ranked teams for Georgetown, and they get a break there as Syracuse throws it away.
That'll do two things. First of all, it asks the Syracuse offense to think, but it does sacrifice time of possession.
So look at Coach John Desco, the winningest active coach percentage-wise in NCAA Division I lacrosse. Coming off career win number 150 at his alma mater. Knocked off number 2 Virginia last Friday here on ESPNU. 12-10. This is Hostetler, Dan Hostetler. Another pro selection by the Bayhawks. Gives it up to Emily. Speaking of Paul Carcaterra, let's check in with him down on the field.
Well, Eamon, we mentioned the defensive woes for Georgetown. They've always been known for an aggressive style of defense. Players still feel it's a strong point of the team, and they need to possess respect and stop turning the ball over on clears and offense. Eventually, the goals they're giving up will go down. Not happy with the way they're treating the ball in the clears. 4 blown clears in the fourth quarter against Harvard.
Coach Hurek stressed that to us this week as one of the reasons why they weren't able to knock off the Crimson in a 16-15 thriller. So this is Brett Weiss coming around goal line extended, trying to feed the crease. Como there for the backup. The Georgetown depth chart on display. Angel out there as well, along with Stu Shannon. But this is Weiss. Again, another keep it in warning. Weiss being guarded by Kevin Drew. There's the feed inside. Now Shannon, the big boy out of Detroit. Quint, who does Georgetown have that can run by his guy to break down the defense here in this matchup?
Well, they're not going to beat John Lade 40 in orange defensively. With this group out, I like the invert where they take the midfielders behind the goal and work on Ian Zito and Drew of Syracuse.
Angel gets his first shot of the game off. Backup opportunity. Rabideau feeds up top. Weiss can't bring it in. Drew comes out to challenge the ground ball, but Emma is there to pick it up for the Hoyas. Georgetown still has to keep it in the box. Rabideau looking for the inside roll. Gets stuffed. Now there's a whistle on the ground ball. Georgetown stepped in the crease, so Syracuse will take over.
Rabideau attempts the inside roll, all or nothing proposition. Well defended by a close defense for Syracuse that was second in the nation last year. This is John Lade 40, turns him to the inside, then gets some help. Galloway plays the angles from in close.
Lade has had a very impressive start to his senior season, going up against some of the best attackmen in the country. He has taken them out of the game.
That is an understatement. Shutting down Alex Demopoulos of Denver, Jeremy Boltus of Army, and then last week, could he have done a better job against Steel Stanwyck of Virginia?
Transfer from Villanova. Miller gets his hands free on Hostetler, but another save. Ground ball right into the middle. Erman laying the lumber again, but Thompson there to pick it up. Nice save. Still loose. Thompson finds his man. Shot in the goal from Marasco. Syracuse taking advantage of the unsettled opportunity.
Tell you, earlier this morning at 7:30, they had some peewees out on the field, some 7- and 8-year-olds. This goal looks exactly like the kind of action that we saw here while we were getting ready for this game. There's bodies flying, ball squirts out. Next thing you know, Marasco's cherry picking. Pretty easy for the sophomore who now wears that famed number 22.
He'll take it. They all look like nice goals in the box score, don't they, Quint? He'll take it. The sophomore out of Westchester County in New York, Somers High School. So Georgetown wins the faceoff.
Okay, the key to that goal was Thompson, once he gained possession from the scrum in the middle, his eyes were up immediately, and he saw the field. So give Thompson some credit for finding Marasco on the backside.
Georgetown now with it, trailing the number one team in the country 2-0. Both these teams like to score. Georgetown having a hard time breaking down the Syracuse defense right now. So they go up top. This is Casey. Ryan Casey goes behind and throws it away. As Morabito can't handle the pass, but it was deflected by a Syracuse defender, so it'll stay white ball. There's a look at Georgetown head coach Dave Yurick in his 22nd season in our nation's capital. 211 career wins with the Hoyas. He, of course, also had a tremendous career at Hobart. There's a feed and a catch made and a goal. Emma puts Georgetown on the board with a fancy behind-the-back shot.
Tell you, this kid was a spectacular high school player up the road here in Baltimore. Dave Yurick's crew breaks the ice. Got a great game sense. He finds the seam in the defense. You see his man stare inside. Number 10 in orange is Brian McGill. Ball watching, and Emila flashes to that back post, and the behind-the-back shot actually increases his angle. Great start to the season. 13 goals in his fifth game.
Out of Gilman High School, as Quint mentioned, here in Baltimore. Tab wins the faceoff. There's also a nice feed by Casey. Cross crease feed. Georgetown starting to dominate the faceoffs, winning three of the first four here. That was a concern for Coach Yurick.
Okay, one thing Georgetown has done much better this year, shooting percentage. In the past, they've been around 25%. So far this season, they're at 34%. And that's thanks to guys like Emma, who's shooting now over 60%. And Travis Como is at 47%. And Zach Angel, who we featured in the open. Dave Yurick mentioned that in our discussions this week. Really happy with shot selection.
Coach Yurick's son, Scott, who is a great player at Georgetown, running the offense for his dad.
Think back to this Georgetown offense for so many years. It was about Andrew Brancaccio and Scott Kosas, big, gigantic midfielders who would blast from 18 and 17 yards, low percentage shots. This year, they get the ball inside.
So we'll look at some new midfielders now for Syracuse as Desco gets the goal line extended, keeps coming. Gets the shot off, but I think Davis got a piece of that one as well. So he's playing well right now.
Desco, confidence sky high.
How about the respect they're giving him by putting Ehrman on 21? Here's Marasco. He can play from up top as well. Last year as a freshman, he played the midfield. This is Ian Zito. Check that feed inside, wide open. Quinn, I think you mentioned that off camera about the green nets. I think that might have been a goal. I think that might have bounced off, but maybe a bad eyes here early.
Keogh wanted it. I think it hit the right post.
Stephen Keogh, 28, definitely thought he had his 11th career goal against the Hoyas. This is Ryan Schuler with it. Let's take a look. Keogh. I think you're right. I think that might have hit a pipe.
Tequil out of Canada. He's got the ability to slow the game down in his head. Shoots about 50% from close range.
Good job on defense there by 27. Pete Coleman to knock it away. And then Georgetown couldn't keep it in the box.
Plays off to a good start. I felt that the Syracuse team under John Desco was vulnerable early in this ball game. Coming off that monumental win last week in the Carry Dome.
So actually, I think a penalty was called on Syracuse, but Georgetown took it out of the box. That's why the whistle was blown, because when a flag is down, if you want to keep possession, you have to keep it in the box. So we'll get a look at the extra man unit now. The extra man unit for Georgetown out there now. 10 of 21 on the season in four games. We're going to look out for Shannon, number three. He has a cannon. Four, David Shriver has a couple of extra man goals as well. Here's Como. This is Shriver right here. Now Morabito. Shannon steps into one high to high, but just a little too high.
I like that. I like early in an extra man. You know, take that outside shot. Send it wide even. It extends the defense.
Seligman, Shannon, a couple of big boys up top who can let it fly. Emily tracks it down. McGill comes out on him. Still plenty of time left in this extra man if Georgetown can settle it down. That's Shriver with the lefty shot. Rabideau with the extra pass to Emela coming around, and he puts it past Galloway. So Emela has two, and we're all tied.
This was a Georgetown team that was struggling to find any rhythm on this extra man possession. They finally did. Syracuse late to slide, late to get in their rotation. That ball pegs the corner and kicks out. Nice pass by Mirabito, but the key here is Emela works hard to improve his angle. He takes that extra step to greatness, changes the level of the shot, and then takes a head shot, a head-to-head contact by McGill that could easily have been called a penalty.
Syracuse is fortunate there's no flag keeping another man up. Opportunity for Georgetown. So we go back to the faceoff. Thompson not taking this one for the Orange. Ricky Buehr was the freshman out of Long Island, but there's a flag down. So another free possession here for the Hoyas. Now once Georgetown keeps it in the box with a nice takeaway check there by Lade. So Georgetown, after just converting on the man up, will play 6-on-5 again with 2:22 to play in the first quarter.
Dave Yurick's done a nice job bouncing back from that Tuesday loss to Harvard. Meanwhile, John Desco.
And he's been asked about the letdown. After the Virginia game, he was asked about it.
It is human nature, and I could see it in practice on Friday. I've never seen so many behind the backs and errant passes from a Syracuse team, in contrast to what we saw last week up in the Carrier Dome, and that's what stood out. They were all business last week. Yesterday, it was like the coronation of the Kings.
Syracuse's first road game of the season. Now Shannon moving it around. You notice Georgetown now playing just a little bit quicker. Shannon. Good play by Guadagnolo. Shriver. 5 seconds left on this extra man. Shannon steps into it. Extra pass to Seligman. Now Shriver, the lefty shot. Didn't really have it in his stick on the quick stick.
Back to even strength. Good defense by Syracuse. I thought Emela was the guy on that last possession who may have wanted to step in and sniff things out from the wing.
When you talk about Syracuse and that letdown, they open up with Denver. First game of the year, they're fired up and jacked up to play. Second game is against Army, a revenge game after the Cadets ended their season a year ago. Third game, number two, Virginia, 14,000 people on hand. How do you not exhale and let up?
Well, you walk into this pro venue, home of the NCAA championships, playing against the biggest rival.
Easy pickoff there for White. He is an offensive threat. Emela back.
And Syracuse will be fine. They're just showing a little signs of not flying around like they did early in that Virginia game last year. A game in the first 10 minutes that was played at a pace that we haven't seen in a long time. That was incredible lacrosse early on in that ballgame.
Credit Syracuse for making the adjustments defensively in the second half to really shut down that Virginia attack outside of Shamel Bratt. So here's Amidon, gives it back up to Marasco. Marasco being guarded by Bobby Boyle. Now Thompson. Miller draws Hostetler. Under a minute left to play in the first quarter. All tied here at two. Desco. Desco driving, gets inside. Rebound opportunity. Amidon takes it behind. Amidon going to work on Boyle. Now Marasco will take a run at Irvin.
Amidon is a catch and shoot midfielder. He is not a dodger.
Oh, breaking ankles. Good slide by Bicknese, though, to stop Marasco. Casey comes up with the ground ball with 18 seconds left in the quarter. Casey's got to hurry. Marabito with seven. Marabito driving hard, shoots, hit to hit a pipe. 2 seconds, Hostetler can't come up with it. So Georgetown all of a sudden carrying the action here at the fifth annual Konica Minolta Faceoff Classic. We're all even at two after one. Here at Baltimore, this matchup has become one of the highlights of the early season in college lacrosse, the fifth annual Konica Minolta Faceoff Classic. Some of the best teams in the country in town today.
Yeah. built tough, hot like a Ford. Hemi muddy, bloody, and bruised up. No sports, everything, anything but ordinary. The crowd stand out, know each other by the number. Feed off the energy. We're sweating in the gym for weeks. The wind is whipping our reach. Body checks, I have a kiss in my cleats. The man behind the mask is a maverick. Letting off, fuck 10 shots for the hat trick. Every wrestler's season has led to this.
There's not a doubt in either of these wrestlers' minds that they're the one that's supposed to win.
Their grueling journey culminates Friday with the quarterfinals, then the semis.
This is gut check time for this big guy.
Then champions are crowned in the medal round Saturday.
Never say die!
The NCAA Division I Wrestling Championship quarterfinals and semifinals begin at 5 and continue at 7 Friday. Then Saturday, the medal round starting at 11 a.m. on ESPNU.
We all have times when we feel weak and run down.
Okay, I need a break. Can I just sit down for a second?
So what if I told you that regaining your strength and feeling renewed was as easy as wearing this?
That's crazy.
This is great.
All of these people are excited about iRenew, the revolutionary bracelet that uses natural frequencies to promote strength and wellness. Just watch these strength and balance tests. Without iRenew, these people couldn't even stay on their feet. After slipping iRenew on, they were amazed at how their balance was instantly restored. And these aren't actors, just regular people experiencing iRenew's effects for the first time.
Highly recommended.
Athletes and celebrities have paid hundreds, even thousands of dollars, but now you can get your iRenew for just $19.99. And we'll send you a second one free. Just pay separate processing. If it doesn't work exactly like you've seen in this commercial, send it back for a full refund. No questions asked. You get two iRenew bracelets, a $40 value for just $19.99. Call now.
All even at 2 after one quarter of play here at the 5th Annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic between Syracuse and Georgetown. Now let's take a look at some headlines in college lacrosse.
Big-time performers from last weekend, Tyler Fiorito, Jordan Wolf, Tom Pileski, Army's goalie, and of course Tim Desko. Pole position, Hopkins out of the top 10. Syracuse remains number one, Virginia's number two. Hofstra making some noise. Midweek mayhem. How about Carolina? Two wins this week. Albany upsets UMass. Harvard takes down Georgetown, and a big win by Bucknell over Navy.
You mentioned North Carolina. They get the automatic qualifier out of the Ivy League. Just kidding. They knocked off Penn and Princeton this week.
And we'll see them play Dartmouth later on March 22nd. And Duke, big win. Great start against Loyola. 6-0 in the first half. Zach Howell had 5 points. Harvard making some noise. We're still at a stage in the season where we're trying to gauge where these teams belong. Who's a contender and who is a pretender?
So the reports of the demise on Tobacco Road of the Blue Devils and Tar Heels much exaggerated after a couple of early season upsets. We'll have that rivalry on Thursday night on ESPNU from Chapel Hill.
Tell you, the Tar Heels last night down 3-0. I'm thinking, like the Hopkins game on Saturday when Princeton took a similar lead, I'm like, this one's over. What a comeback. Those young players really matured on the road last night, led by their faceoff man, R.G. Keenan, Mark McNeil, Nicky Galasso, Duncan Hutchins. Very impressed with Carolina.
Keenan and McNeil, Baltimore natives, right here, having big nights up the road in Princeton. Joe Bresci really has been having to mix and match this year with some serious injuries decimating his roster. So now Marasco from up top taking a run at Riley, the short stick D midfielder. A former football player out of Cincinnati, Ohio. St. Xavier High School goes behind the cage and gets inverted by Marasco now. You see Georgetown getting ready to double pretty quickly on 22.
Okay, St. X in Cincinnati, an up-and-coming lacrosse program in the Midwest, covered a high school football game there earlier this year.
Marasco gets inside, now they double. Ehrman quickly on him, so good job thwarting Marasco's run to the cage. Let's check in with Paul down on the field.
Well, after quarter number one, an upbeat Georgetown huddle. Assistant coach Scott Yurk happy and pleased with the way they're attacking ground balls. Defensively, they think they need to really bottle up Stephen Keogh. That was the tone in the huddle. Watch 28 inside, bang the middle where he plays. And then offensively, get the midfielders more involved. It's been an attack-oriented offense for Georgetown. Midfielders need to get involved.
A great save by Jack Davis, followed by a failed clear. Davis has already made 4 saves, but Syracuse will hold on to it until they step out of bounds.
The clearing game, we mentioned it as a key. Davis comes up with a big stop. Jovan Miller falls in the crease. It's a play-on scenario. So when Georgetown comes up with that ground ball, the refs do not blow their whistle. Ground ball dominance in that first quarter to the Hoyas, 14-7, and face-off. So they're getting the extra possessions that they will need to pull off this upset.
Now the Hoyas looking to take their first lead of the ball game. Syracuse scored the first two. Georgetown quickly answered. This is Drew on the ball, 19 defensively against Zach Angel. Angel's been quiet, looking to create. Drew loses his stick. Angel can't take advantage. Wrong side of the net on the shot. Galloway's there for the ground ball.
Galloway solid as a rock. Have to generate shots from the middle of the field. Get to the football hash marks. Home of the Ravens here in Baltimore.
Miller being guarded by Casey. He backs it up, waits to get some offensive personnel on the field as Joel White comes off.
This is the part of lacrosse that needs to change right now if the sport is going to gain more national interest. This is 30 seconds of this game that is just a flat out throw the ball around and do nothing.
So how do you fix it? There's only one way, right?
Gotta shot clock? A stalling warning right now, we need a shot clock. This is brutal right here. This extended 40-second substitution pattern has got to be taken out of this game.
So Syracuse's quote-unquote second midfield line now out there. This is 27, Pete Coleman out of New Jersey. He's out there along with Jeff Gilbert, Steve Ionzito, Desco. That's Tommy Palisek. He started his collegiate career right here in Baltimore at Johns Hopkins. Palisek gets inside on Ehrman. Good trail check by Ehrman to knock it free. And he gets the ground ball. Good ride by Desco, knocking it away from Ehrman.
Nice hustle by Timmy Desco. Barney Ehrman's got to back up and circle away from traffic. And his goaltender has got to do a better job at availing himself. The goalie is typically open. Okay, that is another failed clear by Georgetown. It's going to lead to an extra possession. Self-inflicted wounds.
And that's probably what Coach Urich wants to talk about in this timeout. We're all even at two, but Syracuse has the ball at the fifth annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic.
Hey, newbie. When I was your age, we didn't have a fancy biz hub to scan stuff. We had to scan it ourselves with a scanner.
You were lucky. If we wanted snazzy color like this, we sent out for it.
Well, we couldn't just send things from a biz hub. We faxed them on slimy fax paper.
It's the Elder.
He who speaks of floppy disks.
You're all soft.
Advanced solutions for today's workflow. Count on Konica Minolta.
Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic is brought to you by Konica Minolta. Count on Konica Minolta for game-winning performance. Maverick Lacrosse, for the players, by the players. Follow Maverick Lacrosse now on Facebook. And Sector Spiders ETFs. Visit them on the web at sectorspiders.com. Welcome back to game one of the Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Still tied at two between number one Syracuse and 20th ranked Georgetown. Game two is Virginia against Cornell. As we take a look, a top 10 matchup.
Top 10 in the media poll. Things that will change. UMass lost on Tuesday. Expect them to drop in this poll. Princeton lost last night to North Carolina. Tar Heels will move up. And later today, it's Virginia and Cornell. Another key game today to me is the Notre Dame at Denver matchup. Tonight in Denver, it's going to be a tough atmosphere for the Fighting Irish.
Sold out at Barton Stadium for Bill Tierney's Pioneers. The Irish stout defense, not giving up a lot of goals at all. That 6-2 score against Penn State certainly opened some eyes.
They get tested tonight in a big way. Mark Matthews, Alex Demopoulos, Cameron Flint. It's a very, very potent Denver offense.
For a drought right now for Syracuse, double-digit minutes without a goal for the Orange. Didn't expect to say that today, especially against the team that had just given up 16 to Harvard a week ago, a couple weeks ago, 20 to Maryland. You got to give credit to Jack Davis, Syracuse connecting on just one of its last eight shots. So an extra man opportunity here for Syracuse.
Georgetown's in a zone, just has that feel. They pack it in the 3-3 zone off the timeout. Great strategy. Airmailed out of bounds, and John Desco, he's got to be the temperature coming to the surface for Coach Desco.
Five turnovers now for Coach Desco's club, and Sunday night, join ESPNU for a special edition of The Experts, as host Lowell Galindo and our experts will analyze every first-round matchup of the announced NCAA tournament bracket. The Experts Tournament Edition is part of Tournament Countdown, presented by Delta Airlines, Sunday at 9:30 on ESPNU. Obviously, both Syracuse and Georgetown will be in the field. The Hoyas seating taking a hit without Chris Wright the last couple of weeks.
You need help with your bracket. That is the show. Keystone Cops clear for Georgetown here. We got 30 seconds. They're looking right into the face of a timing violation.
McKinney in a swarm of Syracuse players, and there is the violation. So the quick restart gets a whistle.
Hoya's going to be forced to take a smart timeout there because they were looking at an Orange transition attempt. Dave Yurick has got to clean up the clearing game right now.
So Georgetown burns its second timeout. We'll step away as well. Still tied at two. All of a sudden, this contest has become offensively challenged as we're still tied at two with 9:38 to play in the second quarter. We go back in time, 2008, inside the Carrier Dome. Brendan Cannon coming around, beating Galloway. The Hoyas had a three-goal lead in the third quarter. They had a one-goal lead in the closing seconds, but after a failed clear, Stephen Brooks makes some pay with 2 seconds left. We go to overtime. We went to double overtime. Brendan Loftus wins it for the Cuse. 9-8 over Georgetown, and that victory really helped propel Coach Desco's club that year to a championship.
You talk about midfielders, guys who played professionally. Brendan Loftus, the great North-South Dodger. Stephen Brooks, picked up recently by the Chesapeake Bayhawks. He could rip it. Number 44 out of Chicago.
Syracuse was coming off a 5-7 campaign, and that victory followed by a come-from-behind victory the next week at Johns Hopkins really made that team believe they could become a vintage Syracuse team.
Hoyas sitting back in their zone.
Thompson. Now Miller.
In Syracuse, you want to attack from behind the goal against the zone.
Skip pass to Amadon. No zone buster there as Davis makes his fifth save of the ball game. Quickly, let's go down to Paul Carcaterra.
Well, in that last huddle, Coach Desco prepared for the zone defense that Georgetown was going to run. He put his man-up unit in there, the six best offensive players he had, promoting ball movement and patience. Not the type of possession they wanted. A quick shot by Amadon, clear for Georgetown.
Dangerous skip pass, but when it gets through, it works. So now the Hoyas, once again, with a chance to take their first lead of the ball game. This is Emily giving it up to Casey. He's being guarded by Jovan Miller. He waits for Seligman to come on the field. Been a while since someone's put the ball in the back of the net here in Baltimore. Morabito taking a run at Lade.
so much for blowing up the scoreboard.
Scouting reports right now, pretty useless. Casey. No angle. Still comes. Goes into the crease, but draws a penalty. Jovan Miller can't believe it. With 8:02 left to play, another extra man opportunity for the Hoyas.
This is the most difficult call that these officials nowadays. That push call. Where is the contact from? Does the player dive into the crease on his own? This is such a difficult call. You make the call at home right here. Yeah, that's a push, Jovan. You're pushing the number seven on the back of his jersey. Good call.
30-second extra man opportunity. Now 11 of 23 on the season, 1-for-2. Seligman was looking for the step down. Good closeout defense by White. Now Seligman gets it back. Here's Seligman. Time, room. Doesn't pull the trigger.
Joel White covers ground so well with that stick. Leads with the stick. Trouble.
That was looked like a pass to Galloway, so now Marasco puts on the brakes. Not really sure what happened there. Didn't not look like a shot at all. Now Marasco going to run at Herman. Herman all over Marasco. Draws the double. Boyle out on him. Now Gilbert, offensive opportunity for Syracuse as Georgetown was caught up in a substitution, but the Orange cannot take advantage. So this is Kevin Drew being guarded by Riley. So now we sit around and wait once again as we'll make some substitutions. This is Coleman taking a run at Hostetler. Ayanzito. Under 6.5 to play in the first half between number one Syracuse and the Georgetown Hoyas. Desco working his way back to his left.
Nice recovery by Georgetown. They show the double to Desco and then recover and find their man.
Ayanzito coming back to his right. Doesn't like his shot opportunity. Driving on Riley. Goes behind. So Marasco looking for some real estate to make a run at Urban. Getting a pick from Desco. Now Syracuse has to keep it in the box. Inside roll, good double. Good switch there by McNeese.
Marasco has no help. The adjacent men offensively have got to step closer to JoJo Marasco when he's doubled. He can pass himself out of trouble, and then you get the ball reversal. It is identical to basketball. Syracuse complacent on offense.
And now Syracuse again has to keep it in the box. Did not think we'd be saying that too many times today. Here's Ayanzito again being guarded by Riley. He gets a pick from Coleman. Ayanzito keeps coming. Draws the double. What's the call there? Timeout by Coach Desco with 5:26 to play in the half. We're going to step away as well, but we're coming right back to Baltimore after this.
Seasons may change, but my game will stay the same. Introducing the Surgeon STS, featuring all climate performance technology.
The theme for the 2011 college lacrosse season so far, just when you think you have it figured out, you have no idea. We expected an up and down game. It's only 2-2. And Monday, spend your day with ESPNU for roll-to-roll coverage of the men's tournament on College Basketball Live. First at 1 Eastern, catch the Men's Tournament Coaches Edition as the experts discuss who's in, who are the favorites, and who will be this year's Cinderella story. Plus, Andy Katz interviews all 68 head coaches throughout the day. Then at 6 Eastern, Tournament Edition looks even deeper into the NCAA tournament. Both programs are part of Tournament Countdown presented by Delta Airlines on ESPNU Monday. All 68 head coaches.
Your Irish gave one away last night, huh?
You had to bring that one up. Coach Desko's club also losing last night as Connecticut and Kemba Walker survive Scoop Jardine's last second shot in regulation and knock off the Orange in overtime. Here, Coach Desko's club looking for its first goal in more than 16 minutes. Again, even out of the timeout, they have to keep it in the box.
Yes, it carries over.
So here's Marasco. What do they draw up out of the timeout? The step down, but Amadon can't make the catch. And you see there, he's smart enough. Experienced senior knew he couldn't go out of the box. Now Amadon to Thompson. Miller. Now they start to move. Amadon to Thompson. Walking the tightrope there was Jovan Miller. Keel threads the needle to Thompson. Low to high. He ripped it. Syracuse back on top.
Playing zone exclusively is slow death in lacrosse against a team like Syracuse, who they have weapons from the outside. Nice little skip pass. Keo Thompson, great footwork on that shot. He catches it, takes that triple step, and lets it go sidearm. Pops the corner. Jeremy Thompson having a nice year.
Sixth pick overall of the MLL draft by the Hamilton Nationals has 1-1 here. And Quint, that was a good example of off-ball play. He moved to create a passing angle.
Yeah, you know, coming off that second timeout by Coach Desko, if I were Georgetown, I may have gone back to the man-to-man defense there. Just to keep him guessing, keep it mixing up. You have to be unpredictable. I like the zone as an every now and then thing, especially, you know, late in the game or late in the quarter to confuse the offense. But you sit back in that zone this entire game, eventually Syracuse is going to unlock the code, and guys are going to start to take good shots.
So Syracuse wins its second face-off of the quarter. So the drought ends in just over 17 minutes. The Orange went 17 minutes and 2 seconds without a goal. But now they have the lead once again, thanks to this man. Speaking of the Georgetown defensive game plan, let's set it down to Paul Carcaterra.
We've seen a lot of zone defense here in the first half. Georgetown also has another defensive wrinkle. It's called combo. I heard it in the huddle. Coach Matt Rienzo, the defensive coordinator, when Barney Ehrman is on the ball, he plays man. The rest of the defense is in a zone. It's like a box and one in basketball. They let 43 and White roam the field and play defense on the perimeter. The rest of the team in a zone defense.
All right, Paul, thanks a lot. We'll keep our eye on that. Miller trying to shake and bake. Good defense by Chris Norse. Now Thompson. Now Amadon's going to invert. Matt Sutherland. Midfielders normally play up top. Now he's positioned as an attackman from behind the net. McNeese comes quickly on the slide. Feed inside, catch made. Keogh making 11 career goals against the Hoyas.
Exceptional offense starts with an invert by Amadon, who draws the double and kicks it to the wing. See the two white jerseys, 9 and 36 on Amadon? And then that wing player becomes the feeder. And you get the ball to Money in the Bank inside. Keo, nothing tricky about that shot. The senior out of Canada fighting a thigh bruise. Missed a little practice time this week.
He now has 2 points here in this contest. Syracuse now dominating the faceoffs. Tab and Georgetown had the upper hand in that part of this game, but right now Syracuse has made the adjustments. They've won 3 in a row. And things worked so well after the first timeout that Coach Desko wants to take another one. with a 4-2 lead and 2:44 to play in the half.
And you can just see by his body language and facial expressions, he's got to be feeling a little more comfortable right now than he did about 4 minutes ago.
This is, of course, year two of the Big East being a lacrosse conference. Syracuse and Georgetown have had a good rivalry historically, but now a conference rivalry as we take a look at the news and notes in the conference.
Great start for the Big East this year. Syracuse, number one ranked team after their win over Virginia. Notre Dame still undefeated. Key game for them playing at Denver tonight. And Rutgers, best start in a long time, although they've only beaten teams with a combined 1-13 record. I like the way Rutgers is playing. Look at the out-of-conference record at 17-3, and that bodes well come tournament time. This is a league that I see with at least two NCAA picks. Syracuse and Notre Dame, the favorites, but teams like Villanova, Rutgers, and Georgetown, this league could send as many as three or four to the big dance if they can continue to play well out of conference.
Rutgers with a big game today against Penn State, which is, of course, coached by Jeff Tambroni. And we will see his former team later here this afternoon, the Cornell Big Red, the ninth-ranked team in the country, going up against number two, Virginia. Villanova with a key game today as well.
As you look at Dave Yerick pacing the sidelines and the fans here, temperatures in the upper 40s. The zone was effective early, but what it's done is it's created a half-field game, and it's sacrificed all sorts of time of possessions, compounded with Georgetown's inability to win a face-off, and they played defense this entire quarter.
So an important final, 2:33 here for both teams. Syracuse wants to go for the jugular. Georgetown sort of wants to rebound and stay in it. Good ball movement. Although good defense there to knock down the pass by Boyle. McNeese with the ground ball. Now can Georgetown make a clear?
No. Unofficially, it's at least the third or fourth missed clear. Again, more time on defense.
Monday night, the women's brackets are exclusively announced on ESPN's NCAA Women's Basketball Selection Special. Which teams have the easiest and toughest roads to Indianapolis? The NCAA Women's Basketball Selection Special, presented by Capital One, begins on ESPN Monday at 7 Eastern, with continuing coverage on ESPNU at 8 Eastern. And we're talking to some of the Syracuse people, the Orange on the bubble for the women's tournament, sweating it out. Under 2 minutes to play here in the first half.
I think the Orange women team, they're going to send them out to Waco. Have to play in that Baylor bracket with Brittany Griner.
Wow, Desko rips one off the crossbar.
Get dunked on.
Desko, 5 goals against Virginia. That followed a hat trick, his first career hat trick against Army. 1:29 to play. Syracuse will hold on to the possession as Amadon won the race to the sideline. Thompson brings it around. Miller can't handle the pass. Riley's going to go out and challenge. A couple of good high school football players there going at it. Miller, under a minute to play here. 50 seconds left in the second quarter. Syracuse has dominated the action late here in this quarter. Looking for a 3-goal lead or maybe more going into the locker room. Miller cuts into the middle, gets the pass. Save made. Hostetler rocked but holds on to it. There's a flag, so a free possession here to end the quarter for the Hoyas. This is Schuler, swim move. Syracuse has to come up with it to draw the whistle, or it has to come out of the box, and there it does. So Georgetown, which has only attempted one shot this quarter, will have an extra man opportunity right now. Coming up on the Warrior Halftime Report, SportsCenter U will have a look back at a top 10 tussle with UNC and Princeton, and we'll have a Warrior Pro Session. Matt Danowski of the Long Island Lizards will break down attack dodges. And we'll also have first half highlights and stats. Move your feet. Who is that defenseman? Come on.
What you won't see is me going over Matt's head and just stripping him.
Because that's not allowed anymore.
Taking his lunch money. Carving him up.
So Quint, with 10 seconds, the Hoyas here will just run out the clock and start the second half with an extra man.
Yes, sir.
As you see that Mirabito running away. Showing off his 40 time there. So in the last 15 minutes and 2 seconds of the half, Georgetown took one shot. Coach Urich has to come up with a plan on offense. Syracuse looks like they have found it.
Good news is Hoya's only down by two. Bad news is they were dominated in that quarter.
Let's send it down to Paul Carcaterra, who's standing by with Coach Desco.
Well, Coach, four first half goals. They played zone primarily. What do you do in the second half to break this defense down?
Well, I think we have to be more patient. You know, it took a long time for that third goal to come. We started to be a little bit more patient. We scored, then we were patient again, we scored again. So I think we need to carry that lesson into the locker room offensively.
What do you do to force transition and play a full field brand of lacrosse in the second half?
Well, you know, they've been somewhat patient, too, at their offensive end of the field, and they've been doing a pretty good job getting back and stopping our break. I mean, they know who we are. So, it comes down to the save and some turnovers, and if we can create some turnovers at the defensive end, usually good things happen for us.
Thanks, Coach.
The number one Syracuse Orange, 30 minutes away from improving to 4-0. It's halftime at the Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Syracuse with a two-goal lead. Now let's join Lowell Galindo in the studio. Welcome back to the fifth annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. After two quarters of play, Syracuse leads Georgetown 4-2. Last year, these two teams combined for 27 goals. Safe to say, we have a lot of work to do to catch up to that one. Now, Quint, we expected a track meet. Why does it feel more like we're stuck in traffic on the Beltway?
Oh, man. Talk about false advertising. You know, we talked about blowing up the scoreboard earlier. I'm worried that the scorekeeper may fall asleep, but this game has been very slow tempo.
How do they pick it up? And as we take a look at the first half highlights, what did Syracuse do well to grab that lead?
Well, Syracuse was rusty and ripe early in this ball game, but they kind of hung in there. Nice ground ball play here with this goal by Marasco off an assist from Thompson. David Emela for Georgetown has both of their goals, but it's been a Georgetown team. They've used a heavy dosage of zone defense, and what that's done is it's slowed the pace of this ball game down. It's asked Syracuse's offense to think, and late in that second quarter, I thought they started to crack the code. First, an outside shot by Jeremy Thompson, who has 2 points, and then Amadon draws the double team. Ball ends up inside to their Canadian sniper, Stephen Keough. Next thing you know, Syracuse dominates that second quarter. They won all the draws. They won all three faceoffs, and the clearing game for Georgetown really hurt them in that second quarter with three failed clears in the second quarter. It's time of possession advantage way in Syracuse's favor.
Possession's 9/10 of the law. That's why Georgetown only took one shot in the second quarter. They just didn't have the ball, but the Hoyas will start the third quarter with an extra man opportunity. 42 seconds left. They play 6-on-5. They get it to Angel, who's been very quiet. Seligman can't catch the pass. He quickly gets doubled. Shovels it back in. Emma there to come up with it. With 19 seconds left in the extra man.
This is a huge opportunity. I can't underscore it.
Now 10 seconds left. Seligman steps inside. Looking for Angel cutting into the middle. And that pass gets knocked down. Guadagnolo, we did that a bunch of times last week against Virginia. He does it again. Now White. He is an offensive threat with Jets. But good job by Seligman to get back until the pass to Marasco. And his shot got knocked down by Norse.
Picked clean by Chris Norse, the sophomore from New York. Nice play in transition defense by Georgetown.
So, Quinn, if you were Dave Urich and his assistant coach, his son Scott Urich, what do you draw up offensively to get going on this field?
Well, you finally have the ball. I thought when they inverted, took their middies behind the goal, that gave them the best chance. I don't like Georgetown's matchups against the Syracuse close defense. I think they need to attack the midfielders.
There's Angel being guarded by Drew. He draws the slide. And McGill, wide open is Casey. Lines it up, but too high. Let's send it down and check in with Paul Carcaterra.
Well, I spoke to Coach Yurick coming out of the tunnel. They plan on staying in a zone defense, but giving multiple looks, not giving the Orange a steady diet of one type of zone defense. Offensively, they're not able to get into a flow. He was quite obvious why that was happening, because of their inability to win faceoffs and control tempo. If they want to get on a run, they have to win the faceoffs and dominate the X. They're going to take a hard look at the second half of how they approach this and mix things up.
All right, Paul, thanks. So after no shots in 14 minutes, all of a sudden it felt like a shooting gallery for Brian Casey, but he's unable to beat Galloway with two shots. So Syracuse will go to work on offense. Herman all over Desco. So now Marasco. They're definitely coming out and challenging now here early on this possession.
They are free to come out and press the ball while Syracuse is in their lengthy substitution. Joel White still yet to run off the field. As I mentioned earlier in the first half, this is the part of lacrosse that we got to clean up. This is 30 seconds of nothing. When you think about it, you add that up over the course of a game, and we're only playing 40 of the 60 minutes. Robbing the fans.
Shot clock and speeding up the game has all of a sudden become a major topic after some of the scores. Hostetler with a nice ground ball in the middle of the field.
He's played a good game, 23, with the hair hanging out of the back of his jersey.
Riley can't make the catch, though, and he picks up the ground ball to get it to Sellerman. So unsettled opportunity for the Hoyas. Do they push it? Here's Morabito. Driving to his right, hands free, and he beats Galloway. It took a while, but Georgetown finally has three.
Over 20 minutes between goals for the Hoyas. It starts with an excellent defensive stop, and they clear effectively. Hostetler gets him going from the defensive end. Morabito dodges before the defense can get settled. He had all sorts of space, and Travis Como, maybe the smallest screen we've seen in a long time, 44 and White, perhaps gets in the vision of John Galloway. Spinning, can't find the rock. One goal margin.
Morabito has 2 points. 24 goals a year ago. A graduate student out of Binghamton, New York. And they win the faceoff.
What I like about that shot is Morabito's running to his right. Goalie is sliding with him, body weight moving to the goalie's left, and he yanks the ball in the opposite direction. He was shooting against his path, which is difficult for a goalie.
Here's Schuler, still looking for his first goal of the season after 9 a year ago. Good defense by Drew to come out and contest the pass. But it'll stay White ball. McKinney will initiate the Georgetown offense.
Kevin Drew, 19 in orange, one of the fastest players in the nation. Dad played basketball at Syracuse.
This is Jason McFadden being guarded by Drew. McFadden looking to feed. McFadden, a sophomore out of this area, played at Calvert Hall. Georgetown's drought was just under 21 minutes. Now they're looking to score in bunches. McKinney draws the slide, good knockdown by White. He gets it back. He's going to look for Miller, but good defense by Georgetown to take away the passing angle. Drew can run as well. He gets it up to Jovan Miller. Now they have a trailer in White if he sees him. Good defensive stance there by Georgetown, Syracuse. Play 5-on-5 for a while as Joel White plays cat and mouse around the 40-yard line with the substitution game. Amidon being guarded by Schuler. Amidon on the invert. Hostetler comes quickly. Step down from Marasco, shoots high.
Well drawn up by Syracuse. Amidon presses the corner. There's a down screen set from the wing to the inside, and the crease man then curls out into space for a simple little shot.
Under 9.5 to play here in the third quarter. Marasco guarded by Hostetler. Hostetler, a converted midi. Now Amidon. Good opportunity. Keo cleans up the garbage. Loose ball right into the stick of 28. And he knows how to finish.
The instinctive play by Keo here. For years, Tommy Maracek made a living on being the garbage man inside. Keo's there on the spot. His defender should be ball side. He's not. Marasco gets lucky with the turnover. But there's number 28. Career goal 107 on his, still quite a bit of time left in his senior year.
He has 3 points today. 12 of those career goals have been against these Hoyas.
Sported a mohawk last week for the Virginia game. Told me he was going to shave it bald on our ESPN U podcast this week. I tried to encourage him to make that stripe in the middle orange, to dye it orange.
With more on Stephen Keough, let's go down to Paul Carcaterra on the field.
Well, I spoke to Stephen Keough this week about his indoor lacrosse influence and his ability to play the inside so well. He feels he only needs a second to get open. He said unless the ball gets knocked down or intercepted, he will catch it and put it in the back of the net. The Canadian indoor game where players play in small spaces paying dividends for 28 in orange.
All right, Paul, thank you very much. And Quentin, just the last 3 or 4 years, how would you describe the Canadian influence on the sport of lacrosse and how many schools have guys from up there?
You think about our doubleheader today. We got Travis Como from Georgetown. You got a guy like Stephen Keough from Syracuse. In game two, Virginia's going to bring out Cockerton, Mark Cockerton, and then Cornell's going to counter with a freshman. A sophomore defender in Jason Noble, and then a freshman attackman in Bremer. So every team that we see basically in the top 10 has some Canadian influence.
Desco getting himself open coming around, but you can't put the shot on cage. So it remains 5-3. Our second game here this afternoon. Number 2 Virginia against number 9 Cornell.
Cody Bremer. It's a Cornell team that has always had some Canadians, whether it be Greenhall.
So a free possession here for Georgetown as Desco went off sides. So now Georgetown has to keep it in the box. This is Riley going right at the goal. Galloway denies him, but they still keep it. Como there with the quick hands, as we mentioned, the Canadian influence. Good backup by Morabito. They will double the ball. Feed inside. Como's got to keep it in the box. Lade comes out on him. Georgetown stays with it. Rabido. Syracuse not doubling the ball yet. Casey gets inside, shoots and scores. Does it stay? It's a goal.
Isn't it nice when you have the free possession with the flag down, you can take chances? What a skirmish. Multiple shots by Georgetown. Como with the quick release, gets the loose ball. Worst case scenario here, there's going to be a whistle and you're going to go up on the extra man. So why not? Great little face dodge right here to a dive shot. Brian Casey beats Galloway between the wickets.
Casey's 7th of the season. His older brother Trevor, a standout at Georgetown for Coach Urich, a captain of the Hoyas. One of their leading scorers during his career. And the back and forth of the face-off battle, the game inside the game, has been pretty interesting because now Georgetown has the momentum.
Yeah, I tell you, Brian Tabb for Georgetown has put up some nice numbers this year. Coming into today, he was 57%, but he is streaky. And face-offs can be styles. You know, some face-off guys own other face-off guys and vice versa. I'm talking to John Desco about that last week and Dom Stars, your Virginia's coach, about that. You know, some styles, some players just dominate opponents and because of technique.
Miller knocks down Casey. Let's see what the call is. It's a hold, so no penalty, but Georgetown will hold on to it. It's interesting that Thompson has not taken a majority right now of Syracuse's faceoffs, and coming in, he was 20 of 30, 8th in the country. And they're using Buer and Daddio so far as well. So now Angel, still looking to get going, drawing Drew. Save Galloway. Miller cleans up in front. Miller, triple team draws the flag. So great job by Jovan Miller to force the contact and draw the penalty.
The ball didn't want to pop out of his stick.
So there's one, there's a slash on Zach Angel. So this is a huge moment in the game there as we heard the call. Let's take a look at this penalty. Two penalties now. There's the slash to the head. And there's the cross check on Morabito.
Didn't see the cross check on Morabito.
So 6-on-4 for a while here. Amidon, Tedesco. Now Syracuse's man up has been horrible this year. 0-for-8 last week against Virginia, and yet they still knock off the number two team in the country. That shot is high.
I like it. Coach Desco, when we talked to him this week, he says, well, you know, prior to the Army game, our first group of man down needed a lot of reps against the scout team to prepare for Army, so we really haven't done much strength on strength.
2-of-16 coming into this one. You can now make it 3-of-17 as Keo once again making a living against the Hoyas.
Hat trick for Keo. Thompson with his second assist of the day. Extra man. That looks more like a Syracuse extra man. Keo now 13 goals on his career against the Hoyas. Defense in a box. Rotation is late. Keo parks himself on that post. Too simple.
16 career hat tricks for 28. 6-on-4, that's what you got to do. You got to take advantage of that. Very tough for the defense to box it up.
Yeah, but defensively, you want to take away those low wings and invite the shot from the outside.
So Buehr wins the faceoff. Both penalties released after the goal. Marasco.
16 hat tricks for Keo. He'll need a hat with that dew he's been rocking this spring.
There's Thompson.
Now, you know, with the two-goal margin, now it's a little tougher for Georgetown to sit back in that zone because they just sacrifice time of possession. So they're staying in a man right now.
This time they get on the hands of Keo. So he sends it back up to Miller. He's going to take a run at Norse. They are ready to slide, and they force the turnover there. So 4:36 left to play in the third. Georgetown now looking to clear. This was Hoyas' nemesis in the second quarter. Syracuse has turned it over 8 times now. Riley gives it up to Emila, and he sends it behind to Morabito, the quarterback of the defense, being guarded by Lade.
The eraser, 40 in orange. It's about as intense and round tight as any young athlete that we come across.
Best defenseman in the country out of New Jersey. Seligman gets his hands free, but right to the stick of Galloway. The outlet pass. Good hustle back by Georgetown, though, on the transition defense. As Harder puts on the brakes and gives it up to Miller.
Space, he's got space.
Shakes and bakes, gets the shot off. Good trail check by Casey to take a little bit of mustard off of that shot.
Has Jovan Miller been on the field the entire game?
It certainly feels that way, and that's why the Rattlers love him for MLL. Two-way middies are a premium in that league. Here's Coleman. This second midfield group still looking to get more consistent production. Ian Zito scored his first career goal against Virginia, then got hurt in the second half of that one. They're still looking for someone to break through and carry this line.
It's a weakness for this Syracuse team. Their top six do the majority of their scoring. Coleman has one goal on the year. Ian Zito has one goal. Kevin Drew, the defensive midfielder, has one in transition. They're getting absolutely zero complimentary scoring.
Here's Marasco. Now here's Coleman.
Could hurt them late, especially if there's an injury to one of the guys in their top six.
Coleman now has Casey on the switch. Moves it around. Keogh splits the double but loses it. Good check by McNeese. Gilbert with the hustle.
That's not good. That's not good.
His player down.
His head down. Brian Casey had his head down, and this could be a severe neck injury. Unfortunate, he got hit right on the top of his skull. Not intentional, but just the way Casey was focused on the loose ball, his head was down, and you'll see the Syracuse player run right into the top of his head and jam his neck. Watch seven right down low to the hip. Oof. Mention it every week. Safety is absolutely paramount right now in the sport of lacrosse, especially with all the talk about concussions. Yesterday in Baltimore, U.S. Lacrosse had a symposium. They brought in doctors and talked about what can be done in the sport of lacrosse to prevent concussions. Leading doctors talked about not as much in terms of the helmets. They think the helmets are doing their job. They think it's the rules and the way the game is being officiated. They've got encouraged that officials really crack down on high hits to the chin and head.
Good to see Casey get up to his feet and walk off on his own power, but there was a penalty away from that collision on Georgetown, so Syracuse will have the extra man. One for one so far. They just scored on the 6-on-4. This is Marasco. Now Gilbert back to Thompson. The skip pass to Desco gets through. Extra pass to Marasco. Gets away from Ehrman. Nice save. Now we have an interference call. Six saves for Davis, but it'll stay orange because of the interference.
Oh, that call, I tell you, as an ex-goalie, that's the one call that just drives me nuts. You make a good stop, you scoop the ball, you call a release call. Release, so your defenders don't hit their man. And way away from the ball. Like, did it mean anything?
Especially now with a man down, but Amadon can't find the ball. Does Ehrman get there? No, so now a huge opportunity.
Makeup call, moving pick.
No such thing as a makeup call, Quint Kesnick, but the Hoyas throw it away right away.
Another failed clear for the Hoyas.
This is the fifth annual Konica Minolta Faceoff Classic. Dave Urich and the number 20 Georgetown Hoyas taking on the number one team in the country, the Syracuse Orange, with a record of 3-0. This is a Big East rivalry, year two of the Big East being a fully funded lacrosse conference. Syracuse with the ball and a two-goal lead. Looking to improve to 4-0 on the season. This is Thompson. He winds it up right into the stick. Another good save by Davis. He has seven. Can Georgetown come up with it and clear it? Ehrman. Transition for the Hoyas. Como.
Syracuse offsides again. And they have been sloppy in a lot of scenarios today. Not the same sharpness that we saw last Friday up at the Dome.
So another free possession for the Hoyas. They took advantage with the goal by Casey the last time. Now you see they're trying to double the ball. And they do. So good hustle by Amadon to force the ground ball. Good pickup by McGill, but it'll be the Hoyas with an extra man opportunity for 30 seconds trying to draw one goal closer.
Open up the door. 51 seconds to go in this third quarter. Door is open now because of the offsides violation.
Here's Shriver. He's your lefty cannon. Seligman. Georgetown, one of four opportunities with the extra man.
He sensed an opening on the right wing.
Seligman with time and space, but Galloway saw the high-to-high shot.
Too easy.
Can White come up with it? Loose ball, White got popped. If this is Drew, he'll run out some time.
Nobody is catching Kevin Drew.
15 seconds left in the third quarter. Keough out of the box. Keough, what a flip, White. Nice save. 2 seconds left in the quarter. Syracuse will not be able to come up with it. So that's the end of the quarter. A big quarter for Stephen Keough in the orange. His 16th career hat trick. We're getting closer to the edge of this one. We're getting closer to Virginia and Cornell. It's the fifth annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Moments away from the start of the fourth quarter between Syracuse and Georgetown, Stephen Keough has half of the Syracuse goals, and he just flat-out finishes.
Spoke to him on the ESPNU podcast. He talked about getting the goalie to move, shooting to the big areas, see the net behind the goal. You look through him, and his ability to slow things down like the Matrix makes Keough automatic from inside.
Quickly, let's check in with Paul Carcaterra.
Well, we mentioned the Canadian box influence with guys like Stephen Keough, Travis Como, and the second game of the doubleheader, Mark Cockerton for UVA. It's all about their ability to work in tight quarters, small spaces from that indoor influence, not drawn out big fakes like the American game, all little hitch fakes. They get the defense and the goalie to commit to one side, and then they finish typically on the other pipe. It's called a pipe-to-pipe fake. The Canadians do it beautifully.
The key to that fake is they keep the ball in the shooting area up by their ear for the quick release. They don't compromise the ability to let it go at any moment. A lot of those fakes are head and shoulder fakes and body fakes, and actually aren't stick fakes. So a great point by Paul.
Fuhr, the freshman out of Manhasset on Long Island, wins the faceoff cleanly. And the Orange go to work to start the fourth quarter. Desco being guarded by Vic Nice for the pick from Marasco. Now Miller. Amidon with the skip gets picked off by Boyle. Boyle, one of two players for Georgetown whose dads played for Coach Shurik at Hobart, but another. Oh, I spoke too soon. I was about to say another failed clear, but a good play by Vic Nice to keep it in bounds. Dangerous pass here.
You may not have spoken too soon.
Ehrman comes up with it. Bobby Boyle's dad, Rob, and honorable mention All-American at Hobart back in the early 80s.
I tell you, that's a timing violation. Georgetown never really got the ball in the box on either side. Going back to that Syracuse possession, Josh Amidon has really done nothing in the last two games we've seen this Syracuse. He's a second-round draft pick in Major League Lacrosse. He's a time-and-room shooter, a guy who can catch it and rip it. Too often, Syracuse is using him as a primary dodger. He has a cannon from 12 yards.
Pun intended.
And they're just not utilizing his best skills.
Selected by the Boston Cannons, Major League Lacrosse. Probably have to give up that.
Boston's draft pick left a lot of people shaking their heads in January.
So a takeaway check there. Must have saw Quint on the Warrior procession there.
Slicing and dicing Matt Danowski. I mean, we couldn't show it. It wouldn't make Matt look good, but it was carnage.
What was your favorite, the ding dong or the over the head?
I got him once with a nice pencil check.
Any helicopters? Speaking of helicopters, on cue, a yard sale in downtown Baltimore. Keough, but Miller will get called for a flag.
Well, I tell you why. This should be a delay of game call on Miller, who thought the ball was still in the loose stick and flipped at it to try to dislodge the ball.
We had a similar situation to this last night in Princeton off the faceoff, so our officials.
But that, by flipping it up in the air, it prevents the player from picking up his stick.
Well, let's see if they wipe it out. It'll be white ball, but our officials, Dave Pintiaro, Jeff Thibodeau, and Fran Doyle, have gotten together. It looks like they're going to wave it off. So here's the helicopter check.
A one-handed overhead check.
And there it is. I don't know if I'd wave that one off. I think that was exactly what they thought he was doing.
Well, Jovan did not intentionally. He thought the ball was in that stick. So he went after it to try to dislodge the ball.
So 6-on-6 after all that. And this is Casey being guarded by Drew. Georgetown down by 2 as we approach 12 and a half minutes left in regulation. Here is Angel. It's that quickness we talked about in the open. Now being guarded by McGill. Laid on Morabito. So they had Emla on a short stick. They still do. Emla being guarded by Tim Harder. He gets a shot off and he beats Galloway with his bouncer. Davey Emla is tearing it up this season.
What a critical goal. Pressing the corner and just nails that far side low location. He likes his matchup going against the midfield defender. Gets to a good spot. He's able to turn for that strong right hand.
We take a look at today's player portfolio brought to you by Sector Spiders. 4 hat tricks now in 5 games for the sophomore out of Gilman. Coming off a career high 5 against the Crimson. Last year, his 6 goals came in 2 games. So now Georgetown with a little bit of life. Under 12 minutes to play and down by 1. And they win the faceoff. Here's Casey. Casey gives it up to Seligman on the substitution. He's being guarded by White. Miller on the double. We got Seligman behind with Miller, but Casey taking a run at Drew. Good recovery defense by Drew. So now here's Seligman on the invert. Seligman gets inside, slide from McGill comes, so it's a good defensive stance there. But Miller, once again, bouncing off 3 players. This time he can't hold on to it. Como cannot convert the loose change. And Galloway hustles and gets the call. So Como there, the typical good hands of a Canadian box player, coming up with the ground ball, just couldn't put the shot on cage.
I tell you, Galloway earns his possession. Left side of your screen, watch it shot. There's no backup. He knows it. Turn the corner. Dive towards the end line.
Again, when the ball goes out of bounds on the end line or sideline on a shot, who's closest to it?
John Galloway can beat you in so many different ways, whether it's as a stopper, an outlet passer, or leader of the defense.
Desco gets inside. Another good save. No, it gets by. It trickles through for a goal.
Textbook inside roll by Desco. He's been pressing this matchup all day against Barney Ehrman. Stop, turn, and as he's falling, that ball just trickles in. Watch this ball come out of the head of the stick. He actually bounces the head of the stick on the turf, but has the strength and body control to roll that one by the Hoya goalie.
2 points today as the Cuse has a balanced scoring attack. So a violation by Thompson, and now we get a flag. What the penalty is here off the faceoff. Threw the ball away, I guess, after the violation whistle, slowing down the attack. On the on the faceoffs, when you're called for a violation, you are supposed to sprint off the field and give the other team a 6-on-5 opportunity. He knocked the ball away before he came off the field. So now they get an even longer 6-on-5 opportunity. 1 of 5 right now on the extra man for the Hoyas. Who do you look for here, Quint, with your 6-on-5 if you're Georgetown?
All day long, I felt they've had something on the right wing. One more right here.
There it is. There's the shot and the goal. Coach Kesenick draws it up again, and Davey Emelo's big day continues.
Syracuse has been late to that low right-handed spot all day long. Emelo's got 4. Nice rotation of the ball. Quick, one cradle and a pass, ball movement. Emelo starts behind the goal. Front swings to about 6 yards. Catch, plant, rip it.
So now with under 10 minutes to play, Tab goes back out there against Buer on the faceoff. Emelo had 5 earlier this week. He's got 4 today. Do the Hoyas keep it going on offense? We have a violation. It's against Tab in Georgetown.
Kicked the head of the stick.
New face-off rules this year. You can't pin it. Keo out of his comfort area. Gives it up to Ian Zito. Take a picture of this. When is Keo this far away from the crease? Marasco with Norse all over. Every time Georgetown gets within one, the Cuse have had an answer here in the second half. Does the second midfield line of Gilbert, Ian Zito, and Coleman have one right now? Here's Ian Zito. Throwing Hostetler. Now Gilbert. This is Coleman taking a run at Riley. Back to his left. Good closeout defense by Riley out of Cincinnati. Now Desco. So they try the attack. Norse came out for the pass. Maresco looking to make him pay, and he does. The aggressive defense backfires on the Hoyas.
Marasco's got a pair. This one unassisted. Kid's quick, he's explosive. Plays the game at a fast pace. Improving on a week-to-week basis. The quarterback's been a little quiet today. Like to see him carry the rock and press the corner even more. He just loves the game of lacrosse. He's a pleasure for us to work with. Always so excited to be out there playing.
Originally committed to Joe Bresci in Ohio State, which was a shocker. A recruit that talented from Westchester County going out to Ohio State doesn't happen that often. And there's a failed clear again by the Hoyas. And right after the NCAA tournament brackets are revealed, ESPNU becomes Tournament Central. 71 consecutive hours of the most entertaining and informative things you need and want to know to fill out your bracket. The best shows, the best insight, the best stuff. It begins Sunday at 7 Eastern, presented by Delta Airlines.
Georgetown hopeful that Chris Wright, their guard, will be back in the lineup after that hand injury he suffered against Cincinnati. I don't know, was that 3 weeks ago? What you got? What you got from the teams you covered? Spread the love. Spread the knowledge.
Well, Syracuse hoping for a 2-seed. They were hoping to wrap that up last night. North Carolina didn't help them with that thrilling come-from-behind victory over Miami.
How good is St. John's? You've seen them in person a bunch of times.
St. John's is very good. DJ Kennedy's health will be a major question. You just feel for him after playing so hard, finally getting a chance to play in the NCAA tournament. If he's unable to go, that's a tough blow for the senior out of Pittsburgh.
Cincinnati, I've seen in person, they'll be an interesting matchup because of their defense. They can really defend.
I'm a little concerned. I think the Bearcats are a paper tiger. That's out of conference schedule is not very good.
Xavier, paper tiger?
Break out your notes for me. What was their strength of schedule rated?
It's very low out of conference, about 278, I believe.
That's pretty high or low, whichever way you look at it. But back here, Casey gets it in the box. Once again, Georgetown with the ball down by two. This is McKinney being guarded by Amidon.
Things have opened up in this quarter. Four goals from each team in alternating fashion.
Zach Angel looking to get going. Emblem makes the grab on the high pass. What? Paul Carcaterra down on the field. What do you have for us?
Well, Eamon, you mentioned Dave, you're a coach, Bobby Boyle's father, Bobby Sr. at Hobart. I asked Bobby if his dad playing for Yurik influenced his decision to go to Georgetown. He said he would never forget going on a recruiting visit to UVA when the Cavs beat FSU in football. He called it an incredible experience. Yet, the following weekend, having brunch with Coach U and his dad was enough for him to become a Hoya.
Paul, thank you very much. Bobby Boyle, very interesting story. Missed all of last year with Lyme disease. And Coach Yurik telling us this week, a year away from lacrosse made him appreciate the game really that much more. So when he was cleared to play, he really worked out hard to get in great shape. And this summer, a lifeguard on the Jersey Shore really helped him get in great shape for lacrosse season. But really happy to be back out there and playing after missing the whole year last year.
Say a 17 in white makes his Hoya defense better. He's one of the Hoyas who he plays great off-ball defense. He's the best team defender that they have down low. Obviously, a guy like Barney Ehrman and Dan Hostetler cover the ball as Ehrman causes that turnover. But it's Boyle away from the ball that's so important.
Out of the Lawrenceville School in New Jersey, this is Norris in the open field. Norris keeps it. Do they slide to him? He can't pull the trigger, so he gives it up to Casey.
Let it rip, young man.
Yeah, and then he puts it right in Galloway's stick and goes the other way, and you call it a low percentage shot.
Take it high to low, offside, aim for the corner. If it misses, you got to back up.
Isn't that what happened on this field on Memorial Day off the faceoff by C.J. Costabile for Duke? Low to high, beating Scott, high to low, beating Scott Rogers for the national championship in the Blue Devils. Casey goes in. Tough angle shot, but he draws the flag. Another push call. So this one's on Lade. That look says it all right there by Coach Desko. So Georgetown, 2 of 6 so far on the extra man as we take a look at the penalty.
From behind, no question. It's a case of being outflanked.
There's a timeout on the field. We'll be back to Baltimore right after this. Georgetown moving closer to the edge of under 500 as we take a look at our Warrior game track. The Cuse leads by two with 5:08 left to play. Another big day against the Hoyas for Stephen Keough.
Tay, Keough and Emela have combined for a ton of our goals today. Inside players who make the most of few opportunities, who are known for their shooting accuracy, their poise. Under pressure, they've combined for 7. Georgetown hanging around, trying to pull off this, what would be a huge upset and a season-altering win for the Hoyas, this would be.
So the extra man has worked with Emela coming around goal line extended on the right. Let's see what they do here. Martinolo comes out and pressures. Here they go again, but Shannon takes the shot this time. Give me a glimpse of what it's like to be a goalie when someone 6'7 is loading up and letting it fly like that.
Well, you're not as much concerned about the 6'7 as you are about finding that ball in the pocket before it is released.
Here it is again, and again high as the penalty is released. So it's 2 of 7 now for the Hoyas on the extra man with 4:33 left to play.
You're tracking that ball from player to player, but if you try to pick it up on its way to the net on a shot, you got no chance. You have to find it in the pocket, in the stick of the shooter before it is released. Try to read that logo on the ball.
And now 6-on-6. This is Angel. He's being guarded by a short stick Harder.
Good matchup for Angel.
Stutter step. Gives it up to Como, who's been quiet. Now Morabito. Rabideau being guarded by David Hamlin. Gets the goal line extended, splits the defense. Not much of a shot, though. Good double team. Casey there on Desco. Angel coming around, can't make the catch. Tough pass. And McGill there to clean up. Pass up ahead. Nice play by Keogh, but he can't keep it in bounds as he tried to flip it ahead to Harder. Sunday night, join ESPNU for a special edition of The Experts as host Lowell Galindo and our experts will analyze every first-round matchup of the announced NCAA tournament bracket. The Experts Tournament Edition is part of Tournament Countdown presented by Delta Airlines, Sunday at 9:30 Eastern on ESPNU. Should be interesting tonight to see if Kemba Walker can do it one more time. And the Huskies wrap up another Big East championship. Rick Pitino lead New York with another title. Both teams winning in overtime on Friday night.
Referee's timeout.
Trying to clear up some loose ball there.
That last shot went off the concrete behind the goal here and trickled back out onto the field.
So here's Seligman and White once again renewing acquaintances. Como looking to feed inside. Both teams so far this afternoon, 28 shots apiece. McKinney. Looking to invert and go behind on Harder, but he draws White instead. So now they have Como on Harder somewhere there in the middle.
You're going to take Joel White. This is where you want to bring him. Behind the goal, as you saw last week, was Shamel Bratton of Virginia.
Seligman being guarded by Guadagnolo. So is there a matchup somewhere that the Hoyas like? Como behind being guarded by a short stick, but he's not a normal Dodger. Rabideau gets to go line extended. Back to his right, laid there to close out. Feet inside, no catch. Emla comes up with it and scores! Have a day five. Davey Emla, second straight game with five goals.
Hoya fans on their feet feeling it. And they've hung tough this entire game. What an effort by Emla. Just a loose ball in front earlier. It was Keogh on the garbage. This time it's Emla. This is where you show toughness. You know, it doesn't take toughness in lacrosse to hit somebody, but it takes toughness to dig that ball out of a crowd, to know that you may have your wrists severed by a big goon defender who's going to be checking you. And Emla sticks his nose in there and comes out swinging.
He has scored the last three Georgetown goals, and once again, it's a one-goal game. Can the Hoyas come up with it and threaten? Hostetler comes up with a key ground ball. Can he find some help? He does in Riley. Two minutes left to play here. The number one team in the country holding on to a one-goal lead, and the Hoyas are going to talk things over and try to come up with the evening goal, with the evening goal, with 1:58 left to play. Emla has scored Georgetown's last three goals. He has five. Does he have a sixth to make this game all even? Georgetown within one of number one thanks to the play of number five.
He has been a one-man wrecking crew, a one-man band for the Georgetown Hoyas, hanging tough inside over the shoulder, the catch and finish. The ability to turn the corner and pay the price. We see two goals where he dodges to really strong shooting areas. On the extra man, it's about getting your feet set prior to catching the rock. And then this one just shows me toughness. And a guy who's got the blinders on, he's not going to be stopped today.
And he is our Konica Minolta player of the game. Five goals, matching the career high he set earlier this week against Harvard. So now Quint grabbed the clipboard and the grease board. Down by one, 1:58 to play. What are you coming up with here if you're Scott Yurick and his dad?
Well, I think you got to put pressure on the short stick defense of Syracuse. You want to attack guys like Tim Harder, 32 in orange, or Kevin Drew, 19 in orange.
Here's a look at Scott Jurek. For more, for the Syracuse side of things, let's check in with Paul.
Well, Syracuse looking to throw a wrinkle on this defensive stand. They're going to start in a man-to-man defense, then throw Georgetown off by going zone. So any one-on-one play that Georgetown was able to muster up probably will be thrown away by the fact that they're going zone. They'll have to get some ball movement and some team offense involved.
It's a great strategy considering that Georgetown is out of timeouts.
So here's Casey. He goes behind. Emma goes low to low, but Galloway makes the save, his 13th of the ball game. So now no rush for Syracuse. If they get it in the box, they have to keep it in the box, under 2 minutes left. So now they cannot bring it out.
Coach Desko will stalk the official here.
Yep, he's getting it. He's putting the hands together to form a T, and he gets it just in time.
Great save by John Galloway with 1:32 to go in the game, his biggest of the day. This is a high-quality chance by Georgetown.
John Galloway selected by the Rochester Rattlers, and I had a chance this week to talk to their head coach, B.J. O'Hara, and he said, yo, going into the draft, we weren't necessarily looking for a goalie, but when he was still available there, we were thrilled and had to jump him and get him on our squad.
You see Galloway wearing those reinforced thumbs, 47 career records. He missed one. 47 career wins. He missed one NCAA quarterfinal game when he came down with food poisoning up on Long Island when the Orange beat Maryland.
So a win today, he'd pass Jay Pfeiffer for first place all time in Syracuse history, and he then will move four away from becoming the all-time winningest goalie in NCAA lacrosse.
And that will be Scott Bacigalupa of Princeton. Georgetown changes their goalie. CT Fisher, a little more mobile. And you'll see Georgetown now bring the heat, trying to create the turnover.
So Marasco, just like he did against Virginia, trying to run the game out. Morris getting stick to stick, but can't get the ball out.
You got to take a chance here.
You got a double with 50 seconds left.
Look at the poise. A little sophomore, number 22 in orange.
Here comes Irmin, so now he's in trouble. We get another timeout call.
Second timeout. Both coaches are out of TOs.
42 seconds left to play. The strategy there was let JoJo run to daylight. Ran some precious seconds off the clock.
Now Coach Desko's got to anticipate the double right off the whistle.
Goal. 42 seconds left in this one, and then coming up at 1:30, the number two team in the country, led by Towerton Trophy candidate Shamel Bratton, 9 goals in his last 2 games for the Virginia Cavaliers, going up against fellow player of the year candidate Rob Pinnell, one of the best attackmen the game has seen in the last 10 years. Virginia against Cornell coming up next here from Baltimore. So Quint, the strategy here if Georgetown wants to double the ball, goalie comes out right away, or does he have to sneak out of the crease and then go double?
Well, because the ball is placed in front of the goal here to start, you cannot leave, you cannot vacate the net. It'd be too easy of just an empty net shot.
So you see Keogh not coming out here. Some more. Let's check in with Paul Carcaterra.
Well, to piggyback off what Quint's saying, too easy for the offense if a double is right away. In the Georgetown defensive huddle, they're going to slide from the crease, give a couple of seconds for this offense to develop, but not double right away. The slide will come momentarily and quick.
So first it was Marasco, now it's Miller. He's going to run some time off. He gets away from Irmin. Now Norris comes out to double. Dangerous situation for Miller. Miller loses it. Free ball. Who's going to come up with it? It's out of bounds. And it'll stay orange off Irmin.
Okay, Jovan Miller ran himself into the corner and turned himself into a double team.
Norris needs to hustle to get there. And Irmin knocks it away cleanly. So 15 seconds. Finds his man, Riley, with 12. Out of timeouts with 10. Riley, not an offensive threat. Moving in. Shoots a score. The defensive specialist ties it up with 5 seconds left. And it all started by number 43, Barney Ehrman, with the takeaway.
Everybody here is on their feet. Ball pops out of Jovan Miller's stick. Hoyas, you'll see Riley, look at him glimpse up the clock. He realizes that there was about 12 seconds to go. Very little options, puts the ball on the 6x6. What a clutch shot.
Now be careful. Thompson can score right off the faceoff. Last year against Georgetown, he scored in 6 seconds. He's got 5 here. He's back out there against Tab. It's actually going to be Daddio right now. A little surprised by that strategy. Hostetler lets one fly, but way off. So the last tie in this ball game was with 2:39 left in the first quarter. But thanks to that man, Jerry Riley, we're getting bonus lacrosse at the 5th annual Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Number 1 and number 20, all even at 8. Sudden victory when we return to Baltimore. Is Syracuse staying undefeated, or are the Hoyas coming up with the huge upset?
Hey, newbie. When I was your age, we didn't have a fancy biz hub to scan stuff. We had to scan it ourselves with a scanner.
You were lucky. If we wanted snazzy color like this, we sent out for it.
Well, we couldn't just send things from a biz hub. We faxed him on slimy fax paper.
It's the Elder.
He who speaks of floppy disks.
You're all soft.
Advanced solutions for today's workflow. Count on Konica Minolta.
Technology select.
Syracuse and Georgetown all tied at 8 as we are set for the start of overtime. And let's take a look back at why we're still playing lacrosse here.
That starts with the defense. A double team is coming. Barney Ehrman leans in. The ball just rolls off the top of Jovan Miller's cross. Just a little too much pressure. Then at the other end, you run in. No slide comes. You know, defensively, maybe Syracuse overthought that to give a guy like Jerry Riley an open look.
Riley's second goal of the season sends us to overtime as we take a look at the rules. Sudden victory. 4 minute periods until a team scores. There'll be a 2 minute intermission between periods, and each team gets one timeout. And Quinn, it all starts with a faceoff.
For the game, Georgetown leading in that category 11-8, but a weird game faceoff wise. Hoyas won 4 of the first 5 and have won the last 3.
It'll be Tab against Daddio. Daddio, the freshman out of Virginia. Tab, a senior out of Bethesda, Maryland, at Georgetown Prep. The number one team in the country going to overtime. And Daddio pops it out and comes up with it.
Nice help by Galloway, and Drew stays relative to the ball where he can leg it out.
Syracuse will get the first possession. They'll be patient while they get that top midfield line out there. Thompson's out there. Amidon's out there. And Coach Desco's going to call a timeout before Jovan Miller gets out there.
Big faceoff by Chris Daddio, who's off to an excellent start. Fireplug of a freshman at 5'10", 191. And in limited duty this year, he's been terrific.
He was 5 of 9 a week ago against Virginia. This is how we ended up in overtime. There you see Miller losing it. Then with 15 seconds left.
Tay, right here, just Amidon totally under respects the speed of Jerry Riley, who, when we watched this Georgetown team play in Jacksonville, we said to ourselves, we're setting up in the booth, like, who's 41 for the Hoyas? Because that kid can run. And Amidon took a bad angle And quite frankly, where was the Syracuse defense? Very content to give up that shot.
All right, let's check in with Paul Carcaterra down on the field as Syracuse gets ready for the possession.
Well, Syracuse coach John Desco looking to get the short stick defensive midfielders from Georgetown on the perimeter. That's where the dodge will initiate, and then look for a seal play, a pick in the inside, potentially Stephen Keogh or Timmy Desco popping up. So we'll initiate against the short stick against Georgetown and look for that pop play inside with 28 or 21 in orange.
Tough decision for the Hoyas is, you know, after so much zone early, they go to a man-to-man late. What defense do you show here? Is this the time you go back to your zone? Put a lot of pressure on your goaltender. Looks like they'll stay.
Right now, those short stick defenders are Schuler and Riley.
That's his zone.
Riley up top. It's like a 1-3-2 almost as Riley chases the ball. Keogh. On the inside on the crease, carrying it on the wing.
You can tell it's his own when Georgetown has that midfielder with the short stick right on top of the crease. In this case, it's 22 in the white jersey.
Hamidon, Desco, still has it, now Maresco. Keogh. Hamidon gets it back. Georgetown being patient, Syracuse being patient. Desco. Now Maresco creeping closer and closer to an angle is 22.
Hey, if Syracuse gets some rapid ball movement and they can get a sneak, get the wheel going, force this Georgetown zone to rotate, that might be there.
Keogh steps in and it's over! Stephen Keogh has another huge day against Georgetown, and number one survives and is still undefeated. Only fitting, Quint, that if Syracuse was going to win this ball game, that it was 28 who gets his fourth goal of the game.
Well, just a little too much of a cushion on the perimeter, and Keogh not bashful. He's going to let it rip. Kind of Syracuse, a lot of ball movement outside. Wasn't bad defense, but a perfect shot to the offside post. Keogh catch, step in, straight over arm release. And he swims his way back to Syracuse. I'm not sure what that celebration was. But the Orange will maintain their number one ranking. And there's the Mohawk.
The Mohawk lives 4-1. He'll keep that head shaved that way when you have a 5-point day on national TV. So Syracuse gives up the lead late, but survives in bonus lacrosse with a 9-8 win. Keogh now 14 career goals against the Big East rival.
He knew it was going to be a senior. Keogh felt the confidence. You could see he's playing with great body language, great energy all day after battling through that thigh injury this week.
Up next for Syracuse, a weekday game against Albany. But the Cuse improves to 4-0 and will remain number one with a 9-8 win. Coming up next, SportsCenter U, followed by game two of the Konica Minolta Face-Off Classic. Number 9 Cornell taking on number 2 Virginia. The preceding has been an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Quint Kessenick, Paul Carcaterra, and our entire ESPNU crew, I'm Eamon McEnany. We'll see you back here in a while, but now let's go to Lowell Galindo and Dino Gordio in the studio.